So thank you for having me. And indeed, as Professor Bruls, Luke said a moment earlier, we conducted a large webinar with over 300 attendees 2 days ago, with opened by the Minister of the North Sea, Vincent van Quickenborne, on autonomous shipping. I have a shipping background. I am actually a master mariner by trade and by vocation, but I spent 30 years in shipping, and I just want to highlight a few key points for you all. First and for all, that is the importance of world seaborne trade, and we're not going to go into details. You can all read much faster than I am, than I can talk, and I can talk quite quickly. But shipping transports about 12 billion tons of cargo per year. Actually, ladies and gentlemen, without shipping, half of the world would freeze to death and the other half would starve. If you then look at the blue economy, and that's a completely different beast, blue economy is all the economy that is related to seas and oceans, as you know, and contributing to sustainable goals. If you look at blue economy in Europe 2020, that's a turnover over 750 billion. The blue economy, if it would be a real unified economy, would easily be one of the biggest players, or the biggest player, in the G7. Employment for 5 million people in 2018 in Europe only. When you see the importance growing quite quickly, because versus 2017, it already increased by 11.6%, mainly in coastal tourism, but also jobs in the offshore wind energy sector has increased ninefold in over 10 years. And substantial financial support. Now, we are in Greece, and every year when I teach my course in shipping and shipping management at the University of Antwerp, the first thing I say to my students is, if you want to be successful in shipping, please learn Greek. Greece controls by far the largest ocean-going fleet in the world. And if you look at the... If you look at the... total Greece, Japan, and China control over 40% of the world trade. And actually, if this is the analysis of the 35 most important countries, or the top 25 beneficial ownership countries in the world, there is only one country from Latin America, that is Brazil, in the top 25, and none from Africa, a very curious fact. All that is served by a mere 1.6 million seafarers. It reminds a little bit the quote of Winston Churchill: during the war, never has been so much owed by so many to so few. If you realize that shipping is good for 85% of the world trade, external trade of the world, then doing that by 1.6 million people is quite a feat. And why all this intro? Because it leads me directly to the heart of the matter. Yes, there are only 1.6 million people dealing with 85% or taking care of 85% of the world's trade, but they are in shortage. And so these are the ISF BIMCO manpower reports. They appear every 5 years. We are waiting for the results from the 2020 study, but every year there is a 10 to 15% shortage in qualified officers for the seagoing fleet. I represent the Blue Cluster in Belgium. I left the stock-quoted shipping company 2 years ago and devoted myself in 6 months to a blue innovation hub, an innovation hub for sustainable developments in the blue economy in Flanders, with the purpose of creating valorization for companies in the sustainable economy. We're active in many areas, 6 domains and 2 overarching concepts: and ecosystem approach and smart sea. As I said, you can read faster than I can talk. So I hope this is clear. 200 companies or 200 members, 186 companies, 118 SMEs, and 17 universities or knowledge institutes, of which, of course, also the University of Ghent. and and so let's have a look at the future. These are two innovation trajectories which we helped, and it shows a little bit the two sides of the coin. On the left-hand side, you have shore supported navigation. I'll show you some examples a little bit later, which is a company which is done by a company called CIFAR. These are live projects. So the ship that you see there is actually a live example. So that is a innovation trajectory that is already concluded with between CIFAR, a company called Encentric that delivers 5G solutions, and Deseo is a ship owner. And then the other hand is still a little bit more in a conceptual phase. It is not concluded also. It is concluded since December 2021. As a SAFE, which is about interconnectivity and interoperability between assets in a maritime and inland waterway environment. And you see there are a few very interesting partners. The one on the right bottom corner is the Royal Military Academy of Belgium, because they are particularly interested in these kinds of projects where you use maritime digital twins to make operations safer, over which more a little bit later. So let's focus a little bit on these two areas. The first one is semi-autonomous shipping. Semi-autonomous shipping. This is actually, ladies and gentlemen, because most people think this is still in the realm of fairy tales. This is the control room of CIFAR in Antwerp. And you can see on the screens that they already now today use this for controlling inland waterway vessels, or even a larger estuarian ship that sails from Zeebrugge to Antwerp and which has to go through the Dutch international waters. It has the question that is often asked, and I do not want to take or too much of your time, but the question that is often asked is, why would you do that? And yes, indeed, it reduces operational costs by having less crew on board. But let's not forget that you can, it's the purpose of semi-autonomous or autonomous navigation, is the purpose of it is not reducing crew. The purpose is, of course, increasing competitiveness and efficiency. And of course, it allows for just longer hours of navigation. This is a little bit how it works. I'm not going to bore you to that with the technology. But what you need, and I will do a little wrap up soon on what kind of technology or the technology needs that you need. But if some of you are fortunate enough, and I'm saying fortunate enough because I'm also fortunate enough to, if you drive a Tesla, then you will recognize a lot of the same technology. But I must say that shipping at the moment is actually already further ahead than autonomous cars. So the shore control center, the captain from CIFAR navigates via direct control or automated control under supervision. And that is a nice distinction to make. It's a bit like an aeroplane. Aeroplanes fly already a lot on autopilot, whilst the captain is sitting in the cockpit supervising this. Here, the captain sits ashore and either in narrow waters or in difficult situations where he thinks it's safer and more efficient, he will take control of the vessel remotely, and otherwise he will just watch after the automated control under supervision. Voilà. So as I said, autonomy is the accelerator, not the goal. And the combination of the vessel autonomy navigation and remote pilotage is key for implementing a smart shipping. And indeed, the result will be that the onboard crew is being reduced, and that you have, of course, centralized control over your vessel. Autonomous shipping is a completely different animal. You have There we are talking about networked systems. And I will elaborate a little bit, or when I do the wrap-up, I will talk to you a little bit more about it. But what you need is a network. And this is an example for a company. The slides are courtesy of a company called DotOcean, of whom the co-founder and CEO is also chairman of the SME committee in the Blue Cluster. The point is that they connect vessels in the network and you offer data services to feed the controller with information. And that is the feed then contains situational awareness information, navigation conditions, weather conditions. And that information is used by the autonomous controller to take path planning decisions. So it's a cloud service where you collect situational awareness data derived from the radar, from camera systems, from the automatic identification system that ships nowadays carry. And you see a few of the. These things are already semi-autonomous is targeted to inland waterways, short sea shipping. Here you have a complete different markets. They look at the purposes for defense, marine contractors, especially for jobs where there is a high risk involved for human beings, or where the jobs are too tedious. I mean, if you have a river that is 400 meters wide, it makes much more sense to have that small ferry going back and forth every 10 or 15 minutes completely automated than having a poor guy who has to sit there all day and steer back and forth over the same spot on the river. This is there is not much value added for his capabilities. Wind farms for maintenance, and of course port and waterway authorities looking for oil leaks, sending out ships, and I'll give you a nice example in a minute. You see, when you compare, port automation is complicated because you have to connect that vessel. That this is a vessel in the port of Antwerp, deployed for hydrographic surveys in a complex environment like a very busy dock, for instance, in the port. And so they connect that vessel, that autonomous sailing vessel, with the port geographical information system and the port vessel traffic vessel management system. And by this connection, you provide the information to the vessel that allows autonomous control. Based on that information, the autonomous vessel can anticipate and avoid other vessels in the port. A few more examples. The next step, this is an autonomous vessel for a company called Demes, one of the largest dredging companies in the world, together with the Flemish Waterway Authority, where they collect and transport waste between two docking stations, one in the middle of the river and one on the riverbank. And so the situational awareness overview is realized by distributed radar systems. It's a very, very interesting path. So they anticipate the vessel traffic, they look at the shipping lane, what is going on, they anticipate traffic, and that is how do you know. And then that is the next step. Okay, this is the first stage. The next step is, of course, then looking at navigation at sea, where even more complex traffic situations and severe weather situations can occur. And of course, this goes without saying, this is an example how the vessel will do collision avoidance just based on radar. And this is then a project that's also a trajectory from the funded by the Blue Cluster between the Royal Maritime Academy, the Royal Belgian Navy, and DotOcean. When you look at wind farms from a defense point of view are a big threat because traditional radar systems, the clutter created by the blades and by the windmills themselves is so big that you can actually sneak in a vessel into a wind farm and you will only detect it when it comes out and when it is already quite close to your port. The point that they try to develop here is to have early warning systems within the wind farm and an automated vessel that as soon as it gets a signal from within the wind farm that there might, that just autonomously, you don't have to do anything, you don't have to push a button, just goes and sees what is going on. And when he sees something that is irregular, that is not within the window, will automatically trigger an alarm ashore, then of course for an intervention, whatever that may be.
Mark,
see it here again. Yes.
Can you go to a closing?
I'm going to a closing now. So what are the largest impediments for autonomous shipping is a lack of regulatory framework, cybersecurity issues and a little bit of piracy, and safety issues. The greatest drivers are indeed lower OPEX, but also, as I pointed out, crew work-life balance, safety and emission reductions. And the biggest needs you have now is a need for a common protocol for exchange of data between autonomous ships amongst themselves and between autonomous ships and non-autonomous ships. And that is a pleading for 5G networks. Let's not forget, ladies and gentlemen, that ships are floating multinational environments, and that this is something that will have to be regulated in a supranational way. There is no single government that can still do it. If you look at the slide here, it works. So you see the flag is Liberian, the owner is Greek, the charter is French, etc., etc., etc. I will not quiz you on the flags. If you want to, you can quiz me. And then is the biggest question, and these are the two last slides. What will the future bring? Large floating structures. You know, you have already people living now permanently year-round, people who are retired on board of cruise ships. So will we have large floating objects somewhere in the world, and I put a cruise ship next to it to give you an idea of what this might be? Or is maybe hyperloops completely autonomous, subsea to transport cargo and connect to ports? I don't know, but I'm sure that I will contribute to this very exciting future for the industry that is so close to my heart. And ladies and gentlemen, believe me, I warmly and solidly believe that our future lies in, at, or on the sea. Thank you very much.